next we will try to cover, we will cover Android kernels. That is mostly we will get driver part in kernels. So that is these five topics we are going to cover. First is Android system architecture, that you all are familiar with this architecture. Then we will see a runtime walkthrough. So how Android system boot and what are the services will start from the booting process to the till system will get up to work. And then we will see for that binary driver. That is the inter-process communication mechanism in Android. And then layer interaction. So those four layers are there: application, application framework, libraries, and Linux kernel layer. So how they are interacting when the some system is using the running the some application or try to access the kernel driver. And then we will last we will check it a power manager. That is also power management driver in Android system. So these are the architect. This is the architecture. So you are all familiar with the architecture. So mainly we will focus on this Linux kernel part. So Linux kernel have some different drivers. So apart from that Linux kernel, we also need some other drivers because we are using this Android system in camera, mobile phones, or some that tablet system. So we need camera driver, Wi-Fi driver, then this flash memory driver, audio driver, and binder IPC driver and power management. So these two binder IPC driver and power management is a major modification in the Linux kernel driver. So what is the Android kernel? So it is not fully, Android is not fully Linux system. It is just relies on Linux kernel 2.6. So why we are mainly using the Linux kernel? Because it is already provide as process management, then memory management, then security, and the network stack. So this kernel is basically layer between hardware and software. So this is the reason why we are using Linux kernel. So that is, it is already contained memory management and process management. So we don't need to create the same code for Android also. And this is a permission based security model. So we are familiar that we can provide a permission to group user and others also. So then the Linux system. So then same thing we are using in Android also. And the main support, main use is support for shared libraries. So those library part will cover that Kaustubh. So in this we are sharing the libraries between different application. So these are the main modifications are made to Linux kernel. First is binder driver, then SMEM, that is Android shared memory driver. That is sharing between the two different application. How we are sharing memories between two different application. Then alarm driver, power management, low memory killer, and kernel debugger and logger. That is already explained. So apart from these three layer, one more layer is that is hardware abstraction layer. So this is the, so what hardware abstraction layer is providing? It is providing the libraries. These basic libraries are C and C++ libraries. So then it provides the interface of the libraries to the Linux kernel. Now why we need this hardware HAL layer? So it is the big first one thing is that not all companies are familiar with standardized with kernel driver. So some need to some modification, then only it can communicate with Linux kernel. So at that time this HAL layer will be useful, and then address some hardware specific requirement are there. At that time this HAL layer will be useful. Now we will see the runtime walkthrough. So how the system will boot? So Android booting is similar to Linux booting. When you will put it power on your Android device, so bootloader will load Linux kernel, and Linux kernel will start the first process, which is init. This init then will start other daemons like USB daemon, then Android debugger bridge daemon, and debugger daemon, and radio interface layer daemon. In this USB daemon is just like a USB connected with USB port, and there is Android debug bridge daemon. So this is the mainly when you are connecting your device to the computer, at that time this Android debug bridge daemon will be used. And this debugger daemon is mainly invoked when your application throws some exception or some error, and that then this daemon is used. A radio interface layer daemon is just your SIM card or that radio interface we use. Once this daemon is started, it will start zygote. Now, what is a zygote? So, basically, application are run on Delvik VM. So, whenever you start application, new application, each and every time Delvik VM will be started. So, each application need Delvik VM. So, if you will start the Delvik VM each and every time, so it will be create some sort of overhead. So, what we are doing, we are putting the zygote process, which will do clone of the Delvik VM. Whenever you it will start only once, then it will put clone, and then clone will be used by application. So this is the Delvik VM install. It will initialize, then it will link OrCore libraries. So this zygote is linked with OrCore libraries. So whenever application will start, it will allow it will link application to this whole library, and share the libraries among applications. So those are sharing libraries. So if initially when application will start, it will not create some different memory space for those libraries. It will share it, and whenever application try to run those library, at that time only it will use copy on write, and it will allocate some other different memory for those library. Now once zygote process is started, so it will start runtime process, that is Android runtime. And then it will start the service manager. Basically the service manager is the context manager for the binder handle service. Once the service manager is completely started, runtime will inform the zygote to start the remaining system. Then zygote will create start the Delvik VM, and it will start the system. Those system will then later on start the surface flinger, that is our surface touch on the mobile device, and that audio flinger. So these both are mainly driver parts. So those are now started. And after this they are providing some sort of services to the other application which we are creating and we are using running. So for those those application can use this surface flinger and audio flinger. The surface flinger and audio flinger need to register their application to the service manager. So they are registering this their services to service manager, and later on this binder will come in picture when you are using these services. So once this is done, then system will start the remaining manager, that's window manager and activity manager, that package manager. So those are all connected with their work, like window manager is managing the windows which are you are opening. Once they started, they also need to register their services to the service manager. So they will register their service. Now system is completely up. Now it is ready to start some application. So now you open the menu on your mobile device. So how it will work? So this is the way it will work. So zygote will clone the Delvik VM, and above the Delvik VM, the home will run. That menu, your menu list. Libc is there in each and every process. So libc are linked in each and every process through the zygote itself. Now this is the we are opening the starting another application. So same way zygote will clone the VM, and it will another application will run on that Delvik VM. And one more thing is that to reduce the starting time, zygote will whenever new application will started, the memory clone will be done by zygote. So application memory structure and zygote memory structure are almost same. So now next we will see the binder driver. So first one is interprocess ITC is interprocess communication. So what is the IPC? So you are exchanging data with some other application, like you have developed some application and which is want to get some GPS location. So the GPS location will give your data, that location of your mobile device to your application. This is the exchange between two different application. So this is the interprocess communication. So why we interprocess communication need? So we cannot directly your application cannot directly call to the GPS location driver, because each application running in your own address space, so they cannot access other application memory area. So for that we need interprocess communication. Then provide the data isolation. So isolation is there through providing own memory address space. And this use of the IPC will interact the it will avoid the direct interaction with the application. So it will avoid the some sort of hacking, or when you are trying to some application will hack GPS location and it will modify the location on your mobile, will show some wrong GPS location. So this will be avoided. So IPC mechanism. So initially in Linux, normal Linux, so what are the IPC mechanism are there? First of all is signal. Just a simple oldest mechanism it is. One process will send some specific signal, and those signal are different. Means, some five type of signal I have. Suppose I will get this type of signal, type 1, then I have to do this type of work, type 2, then I will do this type of work. So this is just some sort of signal, like it is similar to, we can say, some user level interrupt. Then next is a pipe, that is a unidirectional channel, unidirectional channel, sorry. So that is only one way to communicate. If there is a pipe channel between a server, client and server, so either client can send data or server can send data. Both cannot, both of them are not able to send data. So if you want to communicate bi-directional, then you need two pipe between process. Then next one is socket, that is the bi-directional. Your client will open the socket on server side, and so both of them can use that socket to send and receive the data. Then next one is semaphore. It is just a variable. Semaphore can be like a file descriptor. You are sharing, two applications are sharing same file, and they want to use some same file descriptor. So that file descriptor can be a semaphore, or maybe some pointer is there, where pointer is pointing to some array or location. So at that time that pointer is can be semaphore, so that can be shared between two processes. Now next one is the message queue. So in that message queue is a simple list. You have one message queue is there, client is writing and server is reading. After some time server is writing in the message queue and client will read those things. Then next come is shared memory. You have some shared physical memory are there, which is allocated by kernel part, or maybe that server will allocate those memory. And same thing like as a message, the client will write data in that shared memory, and server will read, and some other specific location where server will write, and from that location client will read data. So and now what is the IPC mechanism in the Android? So Android provides the binder, that is the lightweight remote procedure code mechanism. So why we need to create this binder driver for IPC mechanism? So what was the problem with old mechanism? Application server may run in separate process, but communication must communicate and share data. So like if you are using semaphore, so you can just share a variable, you cannot share a bunch of the data. So at that time this you need. And IPC can those old mechanism are providing us some sort of overhead. So when your communication is frequent, means you are frequently communicating with server, at that time overhead will be high. So to avoid that we need binder driver. The solution is that provides some driver which facilitate interprocess communication. So those facilities can be provided by shared memory location, shared memory. And one more thing we can create is that on server side we can create a pool of thread pool, which will reply to each and every request individually. So in if you are using a socket that is for your interprocess communication mechanism. So suppose a client will connect to the server. So 100 clients are there. Then each and every client will connect to different socket. So it we need 100 socket. So server will need to manage this all 100 socket. That is quite difficult than managing the 100 thread. Then next is reference counting. If your memory is shared, so the reference counting, how much client is referring to this memory page is, it is quite easy to refer. And the synchronization call between process. So how the synchronization will not good in IPC mechanism. So suppose you are connected with socket or pipe with server. Okay. So whenever you are writing, at that time server can also be writing. So whenever you are writing some paragraph and in middle of that server will reply. So that is not synchronization. So in this binder, in this diver facility, what we are doing is client will call the server, client will wait and then server will reply. After that only client will again call the server function. Now method of invocation. It may be possible that caller and callee both are in same process. So then at that time we don't need to worry about those inter-process communication mechanism because they can create their object because in same process and they can use their services. So, but what if the caller and callee both are on different process? So how can we create how can we provide the inter-process communication? So for that we need interface. So how we are creating? So basically we are creating the proxy object on the caller side. And we are creating stub object on the callee side. This proxy object is just a proxy, like we are using a network proxy, right? That is, we are connecting to the internet. So same way this client caller will use proxy object to connect to the callee. And this stub object is directly connected to with the server side implementation. That stub object is pointing to the server function which client will use. So this proxy object will call the binder driver that is in kernel, and the kernel will pass the relative to stub object, and stub object will reply back to the kernel, and kernel will reply to proxy object. So this is the very small interaction between two processes. So here is process 1 and process 2. Process 1 is a client and process 2 is a server. So process 2 providing some service implementation, or process 1 want to call the function of the process 2. So how they are using how IPC work here. So process 1 will inform the service manager that I want to use this function, this service, this interface. So service manager will return the object, that is a proxy object, to the client, process 1. And this using this caller interface, that proxy object, it will call the that proxy stub object, that is in the process 2. And the stub object will directly use the server implementation. So this is the blue line will point this directly. So how it is, client will go to the this proxy object, and the proxy object will interact with stub, and then stub will interact with server implementation. So this way how the client will get service from server. So this is the let's see about the binder internal. So some sort of more detail in how binder will exactly will work. So the binder will provide the binder object, that is the interface to access to the remote process. And the binder protocol, that is some protocol to communicate with the driver. So how the driver will work, which value driver will reply on error, or so that is the main protocol. Then iBinder interface. This is the thing which is written by the service manager. So iBinder object will be written to the client, and client use this iBinder object to communicate to the remote procedure. Then binder token, that is the each and every binder have one unique identifier, that is called binder token. So this is the binder, this all our facility are provided binder. So binder is not just providing interfaces communication. So what can you do with by binder? So in the, first we indirectly, So by using binder, you can pass the your shared variable, and you can pass the memory location. So you are you can share the memory between two different processes. Then what is the direct implementation provided by binder? First one is a notification. So some notification are attached with the binder, that is a link to death. So this notification will occur whenever the binder process will get killed. So at that time manager will send the those applications which are connected with those that binder, that your binder is get killed, the you can reconnect it or you can wait it. So this mainly notification purpose is used by Windows manager. So like some Windows is open which is providing some interface, and those interface are connected with binder. Suppose your binder is get key, so still your window is there. At that time window manager will inform that window that binder is get key, you can turn off. So that notification is used by Windows manager. Then calls. So we can call two way, synchronously or asynchronously. Synchronously is two way communication. So once your client call the server, and it will reply for the, it will get suspended and reply for this reply from the server. So that is the two way communication. And one way communication is possible where just client will inform that server, I have written some data, you can read it whenever you want. So that's done, and client will do the other work. So that is the one way and two way communication will also done the binder. Then identifying. So in this thing, whenever a binder client will connect to the server through binder, it will send a data. So in that data, the client will put its ID, unique ID. So that is the unique ID will server will get, and it will identify client whether it is authenticated or not. So for that purpose, binder it is useful. Then managing a memories, shared thread, reference count. So reference count is just how many client are referring to the binder or some memory space. So that is done by also by binder. So now how binder will interact with service manager. So first of all, what we first step is to, when service provider, that is the, our server will start, it will register itself to the service manager. So it will register add service at the service manager side. And the service manager will inform that about registration into the binder driver. Now that client will client can use the service. So client don't know exactly memory address or remote, that is address of the remote binder. He know only interface. Client cannot directly communicate with the binder. So he knows just interface. So it will first go to interface, that is the service manager. So it will client will ask for the get service, and that service manager will inform the binder for the service, and binder will reply the name and address of the interface. So that will pass to the client, and client then directly will use that those address and interface to the communicate with server. So now the binder implementation. So binder is implemented mainly in by three layer. First is our API for application, those we are writing in Java, and then come is middle layer, that is C++ part, and then kernel driver, that is our binder driver, that is in. So first of all is API layer. So in application layer, so mainly we are using AIDL. So what is AIDL? AIDL is Android Interface Definition Language. So what is exactly its task is? Its task is to facilitate implementation of Android application. So it make it easy. So whenever you write some Java file, so after writing the Java file, AIDL parser will use, and this parser will create the class file. So this class file will use a two space. One is to proxy side, that is a proxy object at client, and then use for stub class, that is in a server side. So here this AIDL will generate those proxy object and the stub class. So now that Java API, so those API will try to cover the middle layer. So we try to reduce the H-majors work on middle layer, that is on C++. So now how to communicate with server. So transaction, as you know, sending data from one process to other is called transaction. So what is the parcel? This data sent over the transaction is called parcel. So data can be bunch of the object or maybe some other extra variable like integer or some other thing. So all together will create a parcel. So now we want to send this parcel to the server side. So what we will do? We will do marshalling. That is the building the parcel. So we will create a one whole object that is called parcel, and we will send to the server. So this is the one example of the parcel. So when we are defining the target, then binder driver command, which command we want to run on this binder, then cookies that is used for communication between the client and server, then server ID. So client will identify yourself or himself to server, and then data will come, contain the bunch of object and etc. So parcel is just a container of data, and parcel can be contain flatten data, that is a marshal data, marshalling, and it may be possible it contain unmarshalled data. So whenever you are doing marshalling through some, using some mechanism, binder will send those things to the server side, and server will unmarshal those data, and it will use that data. So to create the parcel, that parsable class is there which will help to write your data in the parcel. So some methods are there, write byte, write stream, or other methods which will write in the parcel. That is provided by parsable class. Now next one is middle layer. So it is mainly implemented in C++, and it will provide the interaction between Java, that application layer, and the kernel layer. And that marshalling and unmarshalling will be provided through middle layer. Now kernel layer, so that is just kernel driver will provide some sort of the system call, that is open nmap or some IOCTL operation system call. So IOCTL basically that control a stream device. So you have some devices there, I don't know exactly which type of how it is working, but it will help try to control the some devices. Yeah, and what is the difference between the binder driver and Unix socket? So in binder driver, server will maintain the status per thread, whether status is running or not, thread is running or not, that thread is suspended or thread will wait for IO. So that status is maintained by server. And in Unix socket, we are maintaining the status of the socket. Socket are used or not, if it is not used, so how many duration went from last usage. So this is just overview how the binder driver come in picture. So first of all, the application processor will ask context manager. Context manager is basically service manager, where all provider has registered their services. So it will ask for service, that is get service, and it will reply. So now it is, once is reply interface, now it uses this interface, and it will call some function to the function with some argument. So that this will pass to the binder driver. Binder driver will do marshalling stuff, and it will pass to the thread at the server side. That thread will do unmarshalling, do some process, and reply to the client. So this is the way the code will return. Now what are the limitations of the binder IPC? So binder use the command to communicate over the between two different processes. So we are not interacting with directly, we are indirectly we are interacting. So it may be possible somewhere we need to access their memory pages directly. At that time this binder driver will not useful. And second thing is that since we are doing that marshalling, so that marshalling and unmarshalling is some sort of similar to the encoding and decoding. which we are using in a network when we are sending a packet. So client will encode the packet and it will send to the server, and server will decode. So same way we are doing the marshalling. So if you want to send large amount of data, at that time this marshalling and unmarshalling will create a overhead. So that is the limitation of the binder. Now we will see the layer interaction. So how basically this layer will interact with each other. So there are only three way to interact interaction. First is the application layer, which will talk with the runtime services, and runtime service will communicate with the libraries, that libc. Another way, another one is application will communicate with the runtime service, then runtime service will communicate with the native service, and native service will communicate to libc. And third one is application will communicate with runtime service, and it will communicate with native daemon, and native daemon will communicate with libc. So daemons are the basically those processes which are running on background, which will not directly interact with user. So which interaction you are going to use? So it is basically depend on the application and libraries. So which is the easiest way and which will give lowest overhead. So this interaction you are going to use. For those interaction, so basically our application and application framework, those two layer are written in Java, and libraries and this kernel part is written in C and C++. So how Java will communicate to the C++? At that time this JNI will come in picture. So JNI is a Java native interface which will define the name coding and convention so that that Java VM can find and call the libraries. And mainly it is a bridge between the application framework and the library. So Java class can use those C++ library and they can. So first we will see runtime first layer interaction. So in this thing, application will call the runtime services. So application is running in application layer, which is top of, and the runtime service is running in application framework. So at that time will binder IPC will happen. So this is the just directly shown. The initially application will first get services from the service manager, and service manager will do replies to the interface, and then application will communicate to the runtime service. So this will happen. Then runtime service will call to the native service which are running in the libraries. So this here is, we are moving from application framework to libraries. So we need JNI. So here JNI will be useful. And then runtime services will use that RA reflection layer library. That is I mentioned initially, that one layer is there between this kernel and libraries, which is providing some C++ stuff and some easy interaction with the kernel, which are not supported direct interaction. So at that time HL library will come, and so native service will call HL library, and HL library will call kernel driver dialect. So here is the example. So here we are asking for location. So how application will work? Application will get interface through binder IPC mechanism. Then application will call the call manager, that is service provider of the location. Then this location manager will ask for interact with GPS provider. So this is our runtime service part. Then this runtime service will communicate with the native services. So this is a so similarly then native service, and then HL library. So here is our GPS location provider. So that is our native service, and libgps.so, that is our library provided by HL layer, and it will call to the kernel. What is the main so in this thing application will call the application runtime. First it will call the runtime service. Runtime service will interact with the native service. Then it will go to the native service part and HL library, and then it will communicate with kernel. So here is the difference between the previous method and this method is that binding IPC, binder IPC. In this case, binder IPC is happening here. So native service will get the interface for the native service binding will get interface for native service, and it will call native service and it will use HL library and it will call kernel. So one is the example is media player. So one application will call the media player. So media player will ask that audio flinger, there are libraries which are used for audio. So the it will call audio flinger library, and they like this will call called HL library, that is lib audio, and it will directly interact with kernel driver. Next one is using native demo. So this is the same path, that application call will runtime service, then it will go to native service binding, and native service binding will call daemon. Instead of native services, it will call daemon. And native service use HL library and it will go to kernel. So this is the example for a telephone. When you are using telephone, means you are trying to call or receive some call or sending the message, at that time this telephone will happen. So application will call telephone manager, telephone call manager, and this will call telephone manager will call RILD, that is a radio interface layer daemon, that is started when unit will start. So it will interact with this is the daemon, and it will call HL library, and HL library will interact with kernel. So now last one is power manager. What are the mechanisms in the Linux for power management? First one is advanced power management. That is the simplest, easiest, and it is the oldest BIOS based power management. So some configuration are there in BIOS, and you will set up, and based on that your monitor will get off, or that will done in Linux. And second thing is the advanced configuration power interface, in which you will can do some more configuration which is useful. So basically ACPI is far better than APM. And what Android use? Android is not using, neither using APM or neither using ACPI. Instead of Android have their own power extension called power manager. So how power manager will work? So basically your device has limited battery, right? Mobile devices have only limited, while your desktop has infinite battery. So which thing you can control in your mobile device? So mainly come in, first thing is come is your screen. So if your mobile is idle for a few 5 seconds, your screen will be off. So at that time you can save power. And the keyboard light, suppose your mobile is with keypad, and at that time your keyboard, you are not using key, so keyboard light we can put it off. So there, this way we can reduce the power in mobile device. So how we are using the basic power? So we are using VecLog. So VecLog is some sort of the signal which we are sending to the power manager, and power manager will interact with the hardware. So there are different type of VecLog are there. Partial VecLog, in which we are keeping CPU on. Obviously we will keep CPU on each and every VecLog, and we will put that screen and keyboard light off. Then we will ask for dim screen. At that time we will start the screen in dim mode, and then bright screen, and then we will completely fully start our screen, and then full back. That is we are putting a screen on and keyboard light also. This is the state machine for power manager. So how power manager will work? Suppose power manager will in screen off state. So if some user activity will happen, then screen bright will done. So screen will start with using full power, and user activity continue, then we will be in screen bright state. Suppose the screen will be idle for some time, at that time after 5 seconds, suppose the screen will get dim, at that time you will get screen dim mode. Suppose at that time some again some user activity will happen, then it will go to the screen dark state. Now when you are in screen dim mode and dim delay is done, which you wait for 10 seconds, still user is not interacting with your device, so you will put that your screen off, that is screen off state. So now how power manager will work? So here is the application. We will send the wake lock, so it will send the wake lock, that is partial, so you will put the screen off. Then power manager will inform the driver, and the driver will create a new wake lock and it will put it screen off. LCD is off here. Then after once application A is done its work, it will release the wake lock and it will inform the power manager. Once this done, power manager will inform the driver, and nothing to run, those we will put CPU off. So we don't have any other application, so we will put CPU off. These are references, so basically this reference is good, this Antony philosophy of an Android. So this on YouTube one video is there for this one, so you can go it if you want. They have described very well how the Android internal will work. So this is the good reference for the beginner.
From the Android team?
Yeah, this is for the Android team itself. Any questions? That is just one PDF is given, that survey on Android versus Linux. So you search on Google and you will get some PDF. In just PDF they have described which things are modified in Linux. And this is one also good PDF, that Android inter-process communication. So it is very big, around 35 pages are there. So they have mentioned each and everything quite in very well detail. Thank you.